That's how you change the world.
Thank you for listening to Change the World with Pastor Vic Carroll from Calvary Summerville. It is our hope that this message will help you grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, with today's message, here's Pastor Vic.
Let's pray. Father, we declare your glory in all of the universe, God. We declare your majesty. Let the earth be filled, Lord, with your glory. We declare your goodness, your grace, your forgiveness, the salvation that you have brought into the world through the shed blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. We declare that blood. We declare that power this morning, God. And I pray if there's anyone here that has never experienced that power and has never experienced the forgiveness and the salvation that you have facilitated through your blood, Lord, I pray that you would convict hearts this morning. I pray that you would afflict the comfortable. At the same time, Lord, comfort the afflicted. We give you honor and glory, and we declare, Lord, in your word, as it tells us that we are to walk according to your statutes, and it brings you glory, brings you pleasure. It rightly communicates what a saved person is to communicate to this world, and that's a changed, holy life. And so, God, as we open up your word, and as you reveal to us the truth of your word, I pray that your power would fall upon this place, that your Holy Spirit, your anointing would fall upon us, that you'd give us the ability to not only understand your word, but to obey it. And so, God, we offer this time to you, and we ask for your blessing, your anointing, your presence to be with us, and we ask it in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. Amen. You may be seated, and let's all turn together in our Bibles to the book of Acts, chapter 12. As we continue our verse-by-verse study through the Bible. Last week, Peter was rebuked by the church leaders in Jerusalem for having led Gentiles to Jesus without commanding them to first be circumcised and converted to Judaism. But Peter explained to them that it didn't have anything to do with him, that was all God's doing. And once he gave them the details about how everything had happened, the leaders of the church were able to rightly surmise that God has made salvation available to all mankind apart from and independent of the law of Moses. And it just blew the minds of those Jewish Christian church leaders. We talked about how God orchestrated the gospel being presented to Gentiles for the very first time there in Acts chapter 10, but that was done privately at the house of one God-fearing man by the name of Cornelius. But then in chapter 11, we saw the gospel being presented to Gentiles for the first time publicly, and in, of all places, the city of Antioch. Antioch was the Las Vegas of its day. It was pagan central. It was a city that was known for its debauchery, sexual immorality, licentiousness, drunkenness, and idol worship. And so it was very much an anything-goes kind of culture. So it was the last place on earth that, you know, these church leaders would expect that God would want to be evangelized. But as we talked about last week and what God revealed to us, is that God wasn't just interested in saving good people like Cornelius. He was just as interested in saving morally depraved, perverse people like me. And that's exactly what was happening when we left off in chapter 11. The people of Antioch were being saved left and right. They were receiving the good news of the gospel. And that was very much a shock to the church leaders in Jerusalem. So they sent Barnabas to go and to check it out and to make sure that it's all true. Of course, Barnabas finds out that it was all true. And then Saul comes to his mind as someone who might be a good fit and very beneficial to the church and the ministry there in Antioch. And so Barnabas went out to find Saul. He goes over to Tarsus and he finds Saul and he brings him back to Antioch. And after remaining in Antioch there for about a year, upon hearing that how the church in Jerusalem had now become very impoverished and had become basically destitute, Barnabas and Saul took up a love offering from the Christians in Antioch and had brought that love offering to the church in Jerusalem. That's where we left off last time. So we pick up our study here in chapter 13 with Saul and Barnabas now back in the city of Jerusalem. Verse 1, now about that time, Herod the king stretched out his hand to harass some from the church. And this is referring to Herod Agrippa the First. There's a lot of Herods in the Bible, and so it can get confusing as to who is who, because they were all cold-hearted and merciless. You'll remember Herod the Great was the one who had sent out the decree that all the male babies in Bethlehem 2 years and under were to be killed because he was threatened by Jesus. That was Agrippa the First's grandfather. And then there was Herod Antipas, who had a role in the trial of Jesus. Pilate had sent him over to that Herod, and that was Agrippa the First's uncle. And so there's a family history of deviant kings here. And though Herod Agrippa I was called a king in Israel, he was not someone who was appointed or elected by Israel. He was a Roman official. He was appointed by Rome to oversee Israel, who, of course, Israel was under Roman occupation at that point in time. Now, Herod Agrippa was a Roman, but he actually also had Jewish roots and connections as well. His wife and even his own grandmother had, you know, were descendants of the Maccabeans. And the Maccabeans were a very, very proud and illustrious part of Jewish history. And so because Herod had these Jewish roots and connections, he sought out and he supported Judaism. So even though he was a Herod and even though he was a Roman official, he was a king who was generally liked by the Jews. When anyone would try to institute other religions or other forms of idolatry, even if it were Romans, Herod would put a stop to it. He would fend off anything that was in opposition to Judaism, and so that made him popular with the Jews. Herod would keep and participate in all of the Jewish feasts and festivals. So the point is that he openly practiced Judaism. He wanted the people, he wanted the Jews to think that he was very religious, but in reality what he was a hypocrite. And so any time that he wanted to party and get wild, he would leave Jerusalem, and he had a palace in Caesarea as well. So he would leave Jerusalem and go to Caesarea, and you know, his life looked a whole lot differently there. And so when he was in Jerusalem, he would act very religious. But when he was in Caesarea, out of the sight of the religious leaders, he would live like the Romans. He would indulge his flesh. And he knew he could get away with it because he had saw all the ads on TV that said, what happens in Caesarea stays in Caesarea. So, again, you know, Herod Agrippa was a hypocrite in the truest sense of the word, because in reality, you know, it was all pretend. He didn't care anything about God. His practicing of Judaism was just for the purpose of placating the Jews. Because, again, giving the pretense of being pro-Judaism, it made him very popular with the Jews, which also made Caesar very happy. When the Jews are happy, Rome was happy as well. Rome didn't like these uprisings and insurrections and those kinds of things. Remember, Pilate, on the opposite end of the spectrum, Pilate was a politician and a leader who was appointed by Rome there in Judea. He was a guy that the Jews hated. And ultimately, because the Jews hated him, he was removed from office. And so part of Herod's job security was keeping the Jews on his good side, and particularly the Jewish religious leaders, because they were the ones who set the temperature and the tone for the rest of the nation. But that's a little bit of the backstory there as it relates to Herod, and kind of brings us up to date to where we are in our study. And so you have all of that going on with Herod, and now this new, you know, sort of ideology comes along that people are calling Christianity. And Christianity at this point was not only sweeping Israel, it was sweeping, you know, pretty much the entire world. Everyone was talking about it. Everyone was talking about Jesus. People were being saved left and right. People who were known to be devout sinners were literally being changed from the inside out. And so you had that powerful testimony. Not only that, just like Jesus did, these new Christians were now continuing to expose the corruptness of the Jewish religious leaders. And they were bringing to light what a charade these Judaizers had turned Judaism into. So as far as the Jewish religious leaders were concerned, Christianity was very much a threat to their livelihood. It was a threat to Judaism, or at least what they had turned Judaism into. And so Herod figures, if I can use my authority to violently persecute Christians and perhaps even play a big part in stamping out Christianity, then that's going to make me even more popular with the Jews. And so Herod was a politician, doing what politicians do, exercising whatever means necessary in order to gain more political clout. And so we're told, verse 2, then he, Herod, killed James, the brother of John, with the sword. So James, as you know, was an apostle, and he wasn't just one of the 12 apostles of Jesus, but along with Peter and John, James was part of the, what was Jesus' inner circle. It was Peter, James, and John who got to witness Jesus in his glorified state there on the Mount of Transfiguration. It was Peter, James, and John who accompanied Jesus there in the Garden of Gethsemane the night before Jesus' crucifixion. Of course, Jesus was praying all night while they were supposed to be praying. They were mostly sleeping, but they were there accompanying Jesus. So they were part of his inner circle. And now James, one of the inner circle of Jesus, that James has been killed. So he's the very first apostle to be martyred. And Luke tells us he was killed by the sword, which is interesting because that's not the way that the Romans typically carried out capital punishment, and it certainly wasn't the way that God had instructed the Jews to carry out capital punishment. What's interesting about that is, though, the Jews, however, later, much after the law, the Jews, in their own writings, in their own interpretation, their own wrong interpretation of the law, they wrote and established that heretics were to be killed by the sword. And so here's the charge against James. The charge is heresy. And he's charged with heresy because he believed and taught that Jesus was and is the Messiah. So he was killed with the sword, most likely beheaded because of his faith. Now, up until now, the church had experienced some persecution. Certainly Stephen had been martyred. There's others who'd been killed even at the hands of Saul. But with the conversion of Saul, who was the church's worst enemy at one point, with his conversion, and then you had Cornelius, a Roman centurion who had now come to faith in Jesus Christ, you had all that was happening in the church in Antioch, and those, very depraved people coming to Jesus. It was exciting times in the church. Christianity was, at this point was flourishing all over. And the church leaders were experiencing great success. But then, you had this apostle who was martyred for his faith. Especially disturbing given the fact that it was one of the three who were part of Jesus' inner circle. That had to feel like a gut punch now to the church. And it brought about an obvious awareness that we are still aware of today, and that going forward there was going to be an opposition to the church that is inspired by none other than Satan. And there's going to be a level of persecution upon the church that became very obvious to them that's not going to stop or it's not going to end until Jesus returns and he himself puts a stop to it personally. We think that's going to be very, very soon. Now, two interesting things to point out here. Number one, remember, during Jesus' earthly ministry, James and John came to Jesus with a request. Remember what it was? They wanted to be Jesus', sort of two right-hand man. They wanted to be his, chief lieutenants, in his kingdom. And in Mark chapter 10, verses 38 and 39, Jesus responds. Jesus said to them, "You do not know what you ask. Are you able to drink the cup that I drink and be baptized with the baptism that I am baptized with?" In other words, are you ready to suffer the way I'm going to suffer? And they said to him, they didn't have any idea what he was talking about at that point, but they said, "We are able." And so Jesus said, "Okay, you will indeed drink the cup that I drink, and with the baptism I am baptized with, you will be baptized." And now for James, that has come to fruition. But by now, James fully understood what Jesus had said to him back then. I think because James, we see, was, you know, he was willing and he gladly gave his life for Jesus at this point. In fact, according to church history, the countenance and the peace that James demonstrated during this whole process of him being tried and beheaded, his countenance and the peace upon him, it so affected the soldier that had been assigned to guard James that he himself professed a faith in Jesus Christ, and he too was willingly beheaded alongside James. The second thing that I think is interesting and important to point out is that when Judas committed suicide, the other apostles got together and they rightly recognized that Judas needed to be replaced as that 12th apostle because he had become an apostate. And God would later replace him, certainly with Paul, because God had always intended that there would be 12 apostles, not 11, but that there would be 12 men who were assigned to that office of apostle in the early church. From God's perspective, Paul was always going to be that 12th apostle, not Judas. Jesus chose Judas and God used him for a specific purpose, but it was always going to be Paul who was going to be part of that 12 apostles team that God had appointed in the early church in order to get the church established. And so there were only 12 men in history who ever held the office of apostle and had what we in the church call apostolic authority. And once those 12 men died off, there was no need to replace them, nor was there any attempt by the other apostles to replace them in that capacity. And as I was talking about last week, people today who present themselves as some kind of modern-day prophet, and they say, you know, they believe that God speaks to them things that he doesn't speak to everyone else, and that they are, you know, some kind of bridge or mediator between God and man. What they really are, whether they know it or not, are wolves in sheep's clothing. Likewise, anyone today who identifies as an apostle. Now, the word apostle just means one who is sent, and we're all apostles in that regard, but anyone who would claim that they hold that office of apostle or that they have been given apostolic authority over the church, I believe they are wolves in sheep's clothing as well, because God had a specific purpose for the office of apostle, and again, it was to establish the church, but that purpose ended once the church was established and those 12 apostles died off. And that was understood in the early church, and I think it's proven here with this example we're given in Acts chapter 12, because as I said, when James was killed, we don't see the other apostles, you know, gathering together and trying to figure out, okay, now who's going to take his place as that 12th apostle, where we've lost another one. You know, we need to keep adding people. We have 12 going forward. That didn't happen because it was not necessary. So James is killed, verse 3, and because Herod saw that it pleased the Jews, the word "because" lets us know that Herod didn't really at this point have, you know, a personal vendetta against the church. He was just trying to please the Jews by killing James. But when he saw that it pleased the Jews so much, killing an apostle, it says he proceeded further to seize Peter also. So Herod is like, "Wow, man, I didn't think it was going to have this kind of effect. Since it pleases the Jews so much, me killing an apostle, I'm just going to go get the ringleader of the apostles. I'm going to arrest Peter and have him killed as well." And so he arrests Peter throws him in jail, and he was going to kill Peter, I think, right then and there. There's only one slight problem, Luke tells us here. Now, it was during the days of unleavened bread. Now, those are 7 days that were to be observed by the Jews, the 7 days immediately following the Passover feast. And the idea was that for 7 days, there was to be no leavened bread. In fact, there was to be no leaven at all in your house. And during those 7 days, you were to take an inventory of your house to make sure there was no leaven. And if you found any leaven, you know, obviously it was to be removed. Well, what does that have to do with us application-wise? Well, I'm glad you asked that. Leaven, as you probably know, was a symbol of, it was a typology of sin, still is in the Bible. And practically speaking, what it is meant to symbolize, this whole 7 days of ridding your home of leaven, it's speaking of a time, you know, that you and I are to set aside on occasion to take an inventory of not just our own home, but our own heart. Take a time to evaluate your life. We should do that from time to time. Take time to pray. Take time to seek God and to try and ask God to identify any sin in your life that maybe there might be something there that you don't even know about. And then when God reveals that sin to you, when the Holy Spirit reveals that sin, then obviously the idea is to go then get rid of it, to purge that sin from your heart, from your life. And we're not talking about just the big stuff. We're talking about the little stuff, any area in your life where you find there to be some kind of compromise with your flesh or with the world. Because 1 Corinthians says a little bit of leaven spoils the whole lump, so you are to get rid of it all. If someone broke into your house and he meant harm, you know, he's coming for you, he's coming for your family, the first thing you better do is you better fight, and you better fight to the death. You better go get that man in a stranglehold and don't stop until he's gone. He's no longer a threat to you. Someone broke in and said, hey, you know, I'm here to rob you, and I'm here to kill you, and I'm here to take everything that's yours, including your family. You wouldn't sit down with him and go, hey, can we negotiate a little bit? You know, can we become friends? Can we talk about this? No. You better act very aggressively and very swiftly. And it's the same is true with sin. Any compromise in our lives. You don't compromise with sin. You're compromising with something that whose ultimate goal is to destroy you. So the point is, here is Herod. He's in Jerusalem for the Feast of Unleavened Bread and wanting to give the appearance of being a good Jewish man. Now, I've taken these 7 days and I'm doing an inventory here of my heart. Well, he can't really exactly kill Peter during those 7 days. And so he just throws him in jail with the intention of killing him after the 7 religious days have ended. And so, verse 4, when he had arrested him, he put him in prison and delivered him to 4 squads of soldiers to keep him, intending to bring him before the people after Passover. So as soon as this religious observance is all over, Herod's plan was to bring Peter out and have him killed in front of all of the people in a very public sort of way. And meanwhile, he's going to make sure that Peter doesn't escape while he's waiting for this feast to be over. Remember, I think it was back in Acts chapter 4, you know, you already had an angel come and bust Peter out of jail. Lefty, the angel's already come and busted him out once. And so Herod assigns 4 squads of Roman soldiers to guard Peter, and a squad was 4 men, 4 soldiers. And so, as I said before, these Roman soldiers, if you've ever watched the movie Gladiator, you know, these guys are bad boys. They're trained assassins. And so you got these trained killers, 16 of them, 4 per shift, and they're going to trade off. You got four per shift that's going to be guarding Peter 24/7. So Herod's like, Peter's, he's not getting out this, he's not breaking out of jail this time. I'm going to make sure of it. And it says now, verse 5, Peter was therefore kept in prison. And then there's that word, but. If you're writing in your Bibles, you might circle that word. But constant prayer was offered to God for him by the church. In other words, though the gates of the prison where Peter was being held were shut and locked tight, the gates of heaven were wide open and were being accessed through what? Through prayer. The church was praying for Peter. They were standing in the gap, and they weren't just praying. They were praying constantly. That word constant that's being used right there in the original Greek is the word ektenos, but it also speaks of an earnestness in their prayer. So they prayed earnestly, which is important to note. Some of you with Catholic backgrounds are used to, you know, maybe praying, you know, empty sort of ritualistic prayers. Those kinds of prayers, I don't think, are going to lead to a very effective prayer life. At least that's what the Bible tells us. It's earnest prayer that is effective. Earnest prayer that is powerful. Not because it, you know, your earnestness now strong arms God, or it persuades, you know, a God who would otherwise be reluctant to answer your prayer, but rather earnest prayer, passionate prayer. It demonstrates, in my opinion, hearts that care very passionately about the same things God cares about. How does your prayer life look? Is your prayer life being guided by what you know breaks God's heart, the things of God? That's praying earnestly. That's praying passionately. And that's the kind of prayer that is effective. So Luke here first gives us the account of how hopeless the situation was for Peter, first off. You know, he's in a prison cell. He's behind bars. And there are several different guarded positions that Peter would have to work his way through and fight his way through even in order to get out, if he could even get, you know, out of from behind the bars. And then just, you know, in case the iron bars fail, you've got 16 trained assassins that you've got to somehow get past as well. And not to mention, you know, when you got four at a time, four of these big, huge Roman soldiers that are guarding Peter, two of them actually would have been handcuffed to him, one to each arm. And so, you know, that just gives a further illustration of how hopeless the situation was for Peter as it relates to him getting out of this. And so here's Peter. He's lying in prison. In just a few days, he's going to be beheaded. And, you know, it's pretty much a foregone conclusion in his mind. Listen, it's already happened to James. It's already happened to another one of Jesus' inner circle. So it's kind of a foregone conclusion now. And so the situation looks absolutely bleak and hopeless, except for that word but. Luke says constant prayer was offered to God for Peter by the church. And listen, what is more powerful than a hopeless situation in a human life? Prayer. And I believe the more people you have praying, the more powerful it becomes. And when you have the whole church praying, look out. Verse 6, when Herod was about to bring him out, that night Peter was sleeping. So it's the night before, just a couple hours now for Peter's to be brought out. Peter, here he is, he's sound asleep. Would you be sleeping if you're about to be beheaded a couple hours? Peter is. He was sleeping, bound with two chains between two soldiers, and the guards before the door were keeping the prison. So here's Peter. He's down to his last hour. Herod's getting ready to bring him out. People are gathering out there in the praetorium. And here's Peter. He doesn't seem too worried at all. He's sound asleep, in fact. You know why? Because he had learned to trust the words of the Lord. Listen to what Jesus had said to him. We look at John chapter 21. Verses 18 and 19, this is Jesus speaking to Peter at the very end of Jesus' ministry on earth. And Jesus said to Peter, "Most assuredly, I say to you, when you were younger, you girded yourself and walked where you wish. But when you are old, you will stretch out your hands, and another will gird you and carry you where you do not wish." And we're told this he spoke, signifying by what death he would glorify God. He, Peter, would glorify God. He had spoken this. When he had spoken this, he said to him, follow me. And so Jesus had already told Peter, hey, listen, you're not going to die by the sword. You're not going to die by beheading. In fact, they're going to stretch out your arms. You're going to die by crucifixion, just like Jesus was about to die. You're going to die by crucifixion. They'll stretch out your hands, and another will gird you and carry you where you do not wish. And he also told Peter, notice that when you do die, when you're going to die a martyr, but when and you're going to die by crucifixion, but when that happens, you're going to be an old man. And Peter was not an old man here yet. So that explains why Peter, the night before he's supposedly getting beheaded, here he is, he's sawing logs, not a care in the world. Because he knew that could not happen. I cannot die tomorrow. I cannot die by the sword. You know why? Because God cannot lie. And so, he's got peace. He trusts the Lord, even right down to what seemed like his final hour. Now, verse 7 says, behold, an angel of the Lord stood by him, and a light shone in the prison. And he, the angel, struck Peter on the side and raised him up, saying, arise quickly. And we're told his chains fell off his hands. So Peter's there. He's sound asleep. Next thing you know, there's an angel standing next to him in the cell. And this angel puts off, as angels do, he puts off this bright light. And the reason that angels shine so brightly is because they have just come from being in the presence of God. Remember when Moses, up on Mount Sinai, he wasn't in the presence of God. He was in just the presence of the glory of God. And even from that, he comes down off the mountain with his face shining so brightly that it scared the Israelites half to death, and they didn't want to go anywhere near him. But that's just because he had been in the presence of the glory of God. So these angels, they give off this bright light. And so here's Peter. He's sound asleep. The whole room, the whole jail cell is lit up like a Christmas tree. He's still sound asleep. The angel has to kind of, nudge him, like, hey, wake up, bro. I'm busting you out of here. You got to get up, get yourself together. And then the angel said to him, gird yourself and tie on your sandals. And we're told, so he did. And the angel said to Peter, put on your garment and follow me. Gird yourself. What does that mean? Well, everyone in those days wore robes. And, so if you needed to get somewhere fast, it's not really easy to run in a robe. Ladies, it's hard to run in a dress, right? So what they would do is they would just take the bottom, the hem of their robe, and they would just pull it up, and then just tuck it in their belt. And that, that freed up your legs to be able to, run very, very swiftly. Interesting that it would be Peter who would later write in his epistle that we are to gird up the loins of our mind. In other words, we are to make sure as Christians that there's no loose ends in your thinking, right? There's so much out there in this world today, and with television and certainly the internet and social media and all that, it's very, very easy for our thinking to be swayed in such a way that is detrimental to our spiritual well-being. And so a child of God, the direction there that Peter's getting at is we need to make sure that our thinking is being filtered not through social media and not through CNN, not even through Fox News or what have you. Our thinking is to be filtered through the Word of God. That is to be our source of truth, and that is to be what guides us through this life. It's crazy out there. It's going to get crazier, and it's the Word of God and the Word of God alone that is going to cause you to maneuver through everything that's going on out there. It's about to get wild, believe me. And so the angel says to Peter, gird yourself. In other words, you need to run. And another thing that I find interesting is if God wanted to, God, if he was going to bust Peter out of jail, God could have just teleported him from there to whatever, the next place he wanted Peter to be, but God didn't do that. And because, anything God does in our lives He requires our participation. He doesn't need our participation. He doesn't need our help to get anything done. But God usually won't do anything in our lives until we're willing to help and we're willing to participate. So God takes care of the supernatural stuff, but the things that we are perfectly capable of doing, He expects and He requires us to do. The Bible says, man makes his plans and then God guides his steps, right? And so if you need a job, you know, you don't try to hyper-spiritualize this whole thing and say, you know, I'm just going to pray for a job and then I'm just going to sit on my couch and wait for the phone to ring. You certainly pray. You get the supernatural thing going behind the scene. You get God at work, you know, behind the scene. But then you go and you make the phone calls and you send out the resumes and whatever it is you need to do. If you're sick, certainly you pray. It should be the first thing you do. You pray. You get the supernatural going in the background, but then you go to the doctor, right? God will do the extraordinary while you and I, you know, He expects us to do the ordinary, what we can do at the same time. So God says to Peter, I'm getting you out of jail, but listen, I need you to run, and I need you to run fast. Gird yourself and run. And so he, verse 9, went out and followed him, the angel, and did not know that what was done by the angel was real, but thought he was seeing a vision. So Peter's like, as he's escaping, you know, he's like, is this real? Is this really happening, or is this just some kind of another one of those visions that God's giving me? And it's important to point out that Peter obeyed God without really knowing and understanding, you know, everything that was happening here. And it says, when they, Peter and the angel, were past the first and the second guard post, they came to the iron gate that leads to the city. Uh-oh, who's going to open the gate? We're told here, which opened to them of its own accord. No one opened the gate. It opened of its own accord. So Peter gets to the gate, you know, and that thing just opens up like he's walking out of Harris Teeter, you know, like the automatic doors are... Well, he triggered something, you know, that opened the doors. But it says they went out and went down one street, and immediately the angel departed from him. So the angel did his job. He just disappears. And when Peter had come to himself, he said, now I know for certain that the Lord has sent his angel and has delivered me from the hand of Herod and from all the expectation of the Jewish people. So Peter comes to his senses. What that means is he certainly realizes that, okay, I'm not dreaming. This is all really happening, and what has happened is the Lord has delivered me. The Jews, the Judaizers, and all the crowd, you know, they're all gathering outside in the praetorium, anticipating, you know, that Herod is about to bring Peter out at any minute, you know, so they're just waiting for the show to begin. They got their popcorn, you know, and they're just waiting for, you know, the main actor to come out, and it's Peter who's going to get his head chopped off. For whatever reason, people in those days enjoyed watching people get brutally murdered. But Peter realizes that what the Jews expected to happen, they know that God has delivered him from all that. And so when he had considered this, he came to the house of Mary, the mother of John, whose surname was Mark. So he goes to John Mark's family, there to their house. And it says, where many were gathered together praying. So the first thing that Peter does is he seeks out other believers, right? He seeks out people who are going to encourage him and exhort him and help him. And being led by the Spirit, he ends up, ironically, at the very place where people had gathered for the purpose of praying for him. They were gathered at John Mark's house to pray that God would deliver Peter from prison and deliver him from the hand of Herod. And literally, as they're praying, God answers the prayer. Peter comes to their door. How cool is that? And as Peter knocked at the door of the gate, a girl named Rhoda came to answer. When she recognized Peter's voice, because of her gladness, she did not open the gate, but ran in and announced that Peter stood before the gate. So this Rhoda, she's so excited that Peter was there and that God had answered their prayer, she's so excited, she forgot to let him in. So she just leaves Peter standing outside the gate while she runs back in and informs the others that Peter is there. I think, I didn't look this up, but if I remember correctly, Rhoda, the name Rhoda in the original language, I think it means dumb blonde. I look it up. I said that in first service, and someone came up to me after service and said, "No, you know, you're a blonde." I didn't even think of that. So Peter's standing at the gate, and there's 16 angry, at least 16 angry Roman soldiers, gladiators, hunting him down. He's running for his life, and if he could just get inside those locked gates of John Mark's property, he would be safe. And I'm sure he's thinking at this point, you know, listen, I really appreciate you guys praying for me. The prayer worked, but if one of you could just please come and open the gate and let me in, that would be appreciated as well. Now, I've always found this little exchange here very amusing, because Rhoda, leaving Peter there standing at the gate and going inside, and now going forward here, we're going to find she's having an argument with the people inside as to whether or not Peter really is standing at the gate. Now, Peter's here. No, he's not. Yes, he is. I don't believe you. I'm telling you, he's really there. Well, just go see. Go bring him. Let him in. You could avoid all this if you just let him in the first place. But instead, she goes inside. Hey, you guys, you know, you're never going to guess who's here. Peter. But they said to her, verse 15, you are beside yourself. You're crazy, lady. Yet she kept insisting that it was so. No, really, he is. And so they said, it is his angel. That's their explanation. Now, the Jews believed in, you know, the idea of guardian angels. But apparently, they also believed that whatever guardian angel God had assigned to you, that he had the power also to make himself look like you to some degree. Meanwhile, now Peter, it says, continued knocking. They're arguing inside, and Peter's out there, you know, hello? Hello, anybody? When they opened the door and saw him, it says they were astonished. Now, you think, who are these people? Like, why are you astonished? What is the point in gathering to pray for something while having absolutely zero confidence that what you're praying for, God can and will do? What's the point? It's like these people are, you know, God, it is our prayer that you would deliver Peter from prison, that you would deliver him from the hand of Pharaoh. Peter's here. He's outside at the gate. Can't you see I'm praying here? Don't interrupt me. God, we declare that nothing with you is impossible. No, really, Peter's at the gate. That's impossible. Now, we laugh, but don't we do the same thing all the time? We cry out to God and we tell him things like, God, I know I'm going through this trial. I know you're bigger than this trial. I know you're going to bring me through it. I know you've got an eternal purpose in what I'm walking through. Or God, I know you can heal me from this illness. Then we no sooner get those words out of our mouths and we're walking around like we don't believe any of it. We don't believe what we just prayed. And it's to our own detriment. Now, Roman soldiers are on a manhunt for Peter, and here you got these people causing this loud commotion and ruckus, all of this noise as they're arguing over, you know, whether Peter is really there or not. And coming out, verse 17, motioning to them with his hand to keep silent, Peter's like, shh, keep it down. You know, I'm a fugitive. He declared to them how the Lord had brought him out of the prison, and he said, go tell these things to James and to the brethren. Not the James who had been martyred, obviously. Here, Peter's referring to James, who was the half-brother of Jesus, who had become sort of the lead pastor, or the leader of the church there in Jerusalem. And so go tell James and the others. And it says he, Peter, departed and went to another place. So he instructs the people who were praying for him at John Mark's house to go and tell James and the church leaders what had happened with them. And then Peter gets out of there. Now, again, what we should notice here is that God has just delivered Peter from certain death, but Peter still takes the necessary steps in order to ensure his own safety. Again, we do everything we can do on our part to make sure we're safe, to protect ourselves. We don't put ourselves in harm's way and then think, you know, well, God's a big God and he's going to protect me. God can protect you, but the Bible also tells us not to tempt God in that regard. We were in Israel last time, a few years back. We were walking in Jerusalem, very busy, very crowded day, and the traffic there just zooming by. We were walking down the sidewalk, and one of the ladies with us was kind of walking off the sidewalk and in the bus lane, you know, next to the curb. And these buses were zooming by, you know, like zoom, you know, like 60 miles an hour or so. And I went over, I said, hey, you mind stepping up on the curb? You know, it's kind of dangerous walking down there. And she said, the Lord didn't bring me all the way to Israel to get hit by a bus. And I said, well, that's true if you will just step up on the sidewalk, because the Lord gave you a brain. And the Bible says that we should not tempt God in that regard. And she said, you know what? You're right. She stepped back up on the sidewalk. So we do, you know, we have to do our part in keeping ourselves out of harm's way. So we don't go out walking in the middle of a freeway thinking, you know, oh, God's going to protect me. If you're sick, go to the doctor if you need to. There are people who literally refuse to go to the doctor because in their mind it demonstrates a lack of faith in God's ability to heal. Are you kidding me right now? That's nonsense. That's Jehovah's Witness kind of stuff. Now, God heals in many different ways, and sometimes he does it through doctors. Sometimes he does it through medicine. Don't put God, you know, in a empty little box that God can only do things, you know, this one certain little way that's going to demonstrate the most faith in your mind. So you take care of everything that's physically possible. Take your medicine. Go to the doctor when you need to. Those kinds of things. God, you take care of what's possible. God will take care of the impossible. I promise you that. Peter here recognizes the danger, and so he clears out. And then as soon as it was day, there was no small stirring among the soldiers about what had become of Peter. So needless to say, that the prison, that place was bonkers at this point. You know, how could this one man behind bars, handcuffed to two Roman soldiers, guarded by four soldiers, and then 12 others that he's got to get by and get out the gate. How could one man escape all of that? And you know, these soldiers, they're frantically trying to find Peter because it was a matter of life and death for them. Because in those days, if you were a Roman soldier who had been tasked to guard someone, if you lost that person, if they escaped, then you, the soldier, would be subject to experience the same fate of whatever this prisoner was about to experience. And so in this case, you lost a prisoner who was about to be beheaded. That means you yourself are about to be beheaded if you can't find him. And you better find him before the king finds out. But then we see in verse 19 that news has gotten back to the king about Peter's escape. And when Herod had searched for him and not found him, he examined the guards. So he brings them in, questions them, you know, how could this happen? Of course, they couldn't give any logical explanation. Like, I don't know. I really don't. And so it says Herod commanded that they should be put to death. And so these 16 soldiers all would have been lined up in front of the people and one by one beheaded. So the people got a show after all. And it says, and he, Herod, went down from Judea. So he leaves Jerusalem. He went down from Judea to Caesarea. He's got a palace up there in the region of Galilee, Caesarea in particular as well. And he stayed there. So Caesarea is in the northern part of Israel, up in the region of Galilee. And it was just an absolutely magnificent, like just absolutely beautiful place. It is now, even in ruins. So you can imagine what it would have looked like back then, having that palace and that amphitheater overlooking, you know, the Mediterranean Sea there. You see the waves breaking right there on where the doors of the palace would have been. So it's absolutely breathtaking. And so it's one of the places that I look forward to the most when we're visiting Israel. But Herod, he's had a rough couple of days. He goes back to Caesarea to escape the turmoil. So he's just going there to relax and unwind. And then now Luke kind of takes us on a sidebar here. It says Herod had been very angry with the people of Tyre and Sidon. But they came to him with one accord, and having made Blastus, the king's personal aide, their friend, they asked for peace because their country was supplied with food by the king's country. Now, Tyre and Sidon are all part of what we know as modern-day southern Lebanon. And southern Lebanon, as you know, borders northern Israel. And with Herod being the ruler of Israel, appointed by Rome, we don't really know why, we're not told, but there seems to have been some kind of a rift between Tyre and Sidon and Roman-occupied Israel. But the people of southern Lebanon, now they want peace with Herod because they needed the Romans to supply them with food. Apparently there had been some kind of famine or shortage of food. And the land in northern Israel to this day is very rich. It's very fertile land, and it has always been a supplier of much food. Much of the world's pineapples and dates and that kind of thing comes from that region of Galilee. So they hear that the king is in Caesarea. He's close by, and so they make their way across the border of southern Lebanon there, and they come, and they're now going to stroke the king's ego to try to get on his good side. And so it says, on a set day, Herod, arrayed in royal apparel, sat on his throne and gave an oration to them, to the people, mostly the people of Tyre and Sidon. So again, there's a beautiful amphitheater there in Caesarea, overlooking the Mediterranean Sea, still there today, by the way. It's been renovated, but this would have been the place where Herod would have given the speech that Luke is referring to here in Acts chapter 12. And according to the historian Josephus, the apparel that Herod wore while giving this speech, it was all sewn together and was threaded with literal silver. And he wore it so that the sun would shine on him, that the sun would hit him there in that outdoor arena. And the reflection, you know, off of him, just this aura, the people would be like, wow. It was like, you know, the Michael Jackson sequined jacket, you know, of its day, where Herod, you know, he's there before the people. He's literally glistening. And he appeared very majestic and very godly, which was the point. So he's wearing this royal apparel. He's giving this oration. He's speaking to the people. And the people kept shouting, "The voice of God and not a man." And so they're flattering him. You know, I don't think they really meant it. It's just that, you know, we're hungry and this guy's got all the food. And so they're feeding his ego. But Herod, because of his ego, he accepts their praise. He believes all of the hype. He believes that he is like God. And so he begins to receive the worship of the people as if he himself were God. And if you don't know, God is very jealous with his glory. And so that's going to be a no-no here. And then immediately, verse 23, an angel of the Lord struck him because he did not give glory to God, or he stole God's glory. And we're told he was eaten by worms and died. Now notice the order there. He didn't die and then was eaten by worms. Luke was the writer of this book, but he was also a physician. What he's referring to here is in those days they had these, the medical term is, you know, roundworms that they had in those days. And there were these roundworms that would grow in your body. And these worms could grow as long as 10 to, you know, 16 inches. And those worms lived off of literally eating your intestines. And so they would literally eat you from the inside out until, you know, you just didn't have any guts left. And so when the angel struck Herod with this disease, it wasn't like he died instantly, but it's that he died a slow, very agonizing, very excruciatingly painful death. The historian Josephus tells us that the death of Herod was a five-day process once he was stricken with this disease. 5 days of tremendous suffering before he actually and finally died. And so, you know, kind of what goes around comes around, I guess, given how he had treated, you know, others and more recently the leaders of the Christian church. And so Herod is dead, and despite, you know, his great persecution of the church, verse 24 says, but the word of God grew and multiplied. Herod set out to stamp out Christianity. He didn't care anything about Christianity. It didn't bother him. He wanted to do it to earn political favor. But he set out to stamp out Christianity. Who ended up getting stamped out? Well, God's not a good guy to fight with, if you didn't know that. And so look what God did here, though. He brought judgment upon Herod for receiving worship, for stealing God's glory, receiving worship as if he were God. And in the process, God showed all of these people who had been worshiping Herod, God showed them that Herod really wasn't that much of a god after all. And then God showed him, you want to know who is God? I'll show you who is God. And so God uses Herod, he uses this evil tyrant to draw people unto himself. And because of what happened there that day, we're told that the word of God grew and that the church multiplied. And Barnabas and Saul, it says, returned from Jerusalem when they had fulfilled their ministry, and they also took with them John, whose surname was Mark. And so remember, Barnabas and Saul had come from Antioch with a love offering for the church in Jerusalem. Now they're leaving Jerusalem, heading back to Antioch, and they're going to take John Mark with them. And we'll stop right here and take communion. But next week, as we get into chapter 13, we're going to see the church continuing to flourish there in Antioch. We're going to see Paul and Barnabas now being sent from Antioch. Antioch is going to become sort of Paul's home church, home base, as he's sent out into the rest of the world. This is going to be his first missionary journey and his first journey taking the gospel into other areas of the Gentile world. And things are about to get interesting. And so go ahead and read forward on that, and we'll pick up our study next week in chapter 13. Let's pray. Father, thank you again for the power of your word, for the truth of your word. God, help us not to be swayed by the enemy, not to be swayed by those voices in the world who have become very, very loud. They've become very influential, unfortunately, and even in the lives of some who declare and proclaim Christianity. I pray, God, that your word would speak to us the loudest in our ears and our hearts and our lives. It would be your word, Lord, that we would seek to keep and hear and obey. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. If I could get the ushers to come forth on the first Sunday of each month, we take communion here. At Jesus' Last Supper, he celebrated communion with his disciples. And the Bible tells us in the Gospels that the night before Jesus' arrest, he was in the upper room having the Passover meal with his disciples. And it says, when the hour had come, he set down the 12 apostles with him. And then he said to them, with fervent desire, I have desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. We do proclaim your death. We proclaim, Lord, just as much your resurrection. Because of your death and your resurrection, Lord, you have made it possible so that through faith, we too can be resurrected from the dead. We too never have to taste the bondage and the chains of the grave. Thank you, Lord, for eternal life. Thank you for salvation, forgiveness, and for your grace. Thank you, God, that just as much as we can look and memorialize your death and your resurrection, we can look forward to you coming for us as your word has promised that you will come again and that you will receive us unto yourself. And to that we say yes and amen. And we say, Lord, even so, come quickly. In Jesus' name, amen. If you've never accepted the Lord, if you need prayer, I'm available to pray with you after service. If you're here for the very first time, God bless you. Thank you for joining us. Make yourselves at home when it begins. Let's all stand and we'll close. I love you, Lord, and I lift my voice to worship you. Oh, my soul, rejoice. Take joy, my King, in what you hear. May it be a sweet, sweet sound in your ear.
That's how you change the world.
Thank you for listening to Change the World with Pastor Vic Carroll from Calvary Summerville. It is our hope that this message will help you grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ.